Tesla, my Esla. Tesla stock is the subject of today's video here today, folks. Okay, I got two for me to react to. It's a buy one, get one free. First one up here, a friend texts me this over this morning, and he's like, check this out. This was from 10 years ago. They're talking about Tesla stock here. It's about a 2-minute clip, so I want to play this for you. Craig Irwin talking about Gordon Johnson, everybody's favorite Tesla bear, Gordon Johnson, speaking about Tesla stock. And this stock's been such a debated stock for so long. I mean, I started investing in Tesla, it was like 2018, 2019, but I can tell you, way before I was involved in this stock, this was a debated stock for the longest time. And so that's gonna be a fun one. And this one from 48 hours ago, we're gonna listen to these folks take on Tesla, if they think it's overvalued here, kind of what they're thinking is the next move for Tesla and those sorts of things. So appreciate everybody joining me as always. Thanks so much, folks. We just hit over 1,000% gain back again on good old Tesla, my Tesla, which tells you that stock has been rolling. Okay, absolutely rolling. So appreciate y'all. 29,000 plus subscribers now on the channel. Holy smoke, this is a new all-time high. Tesla, all-time high eventually here, baby, okay? Appreciate y'all. Let's get into this.
...is like a typical growth stock. You've got to look at the addressable market and ask yourself, do you believe? So the people that believe on Tesla, like myself, look out to the...
Wow, $16, $17 billion market cap there roughly back then. And today, for reference, Tesla's market cap would be about... I think Tesla right now is probably in the $750 billion, $850 billion range as of right now. Keep in mind, Tesla stock price has split many, many times. So the stock price back then was probably, on a split adjusted basis, was probably $3 to maybe $6 is my guess, based upon all the splits that Tesla stock price has done over time.
And say, you know what? This company has a very interesting edge, and it has a trajectory which says that, you know what? If they keep executing the way they have, they could easily be something like BMW over the next 20, 30 years. If that's the case, what's the earnings going to look like? Maybe 50, 60 bucks a share?
It's interesting. You know, back in those days, you know, people were speaking about this. Maybe this could be a BMW type company, right? Kind of a little higher end and kind of cater to that market. And now, obviously, the debate for Tesla now is not, are they going to be BMW? It's, are they going to put up Toyota type numbers? You know, like 10 million vehicles a year, those sorts of numbers.
Now, that's not in the time horizon that I usually model things out or try and value something on. So, for me, I'm looking at 17 and I'm saying 10 bucks a share. And at that point, you know, they're still going to be doubling earnings. So give it a growth multiple on 17, discount that back. You know, that's a fair way to look at things. Just to touch your issues that that you were highlighting about ZEV credits, if you got a problem with that, you should probably highlight to the California Air Resource Board. I think Tesla's really just being very smart, leveraging the opportunity there. Now, ZEV credits were a 6.8% quarter-over-quarter headwind for the company. That actually came in $15 million below my model, and they still beat fairly handily. So, you know, ZEV credits are becoming a past story, obviously a very nice cash contribution to the company over the last couple quarters. For GAAP earnings, yes, ZEV credits were part of the upside of the prior two quarters on a GAAP basis, where the non-GAAP up not as significant, but... You know, I think if someone's looking at the...
By the way, if any Tesla shareholder wants to leave a comment on what Tesla stock price here was at that time, right? It says 139, but obviously Tesla stock has split so many times over the years. Love to hear from you guys. I could run the math on it. My guess is, I'm thinking like somewhere between $3 and $6 a share is my guess off the top of my head, based upon how many times Tesla split over the years.
They can see this as sort of really interesting opportunity.
All right, Craig, we're going to leave it there. Thanks for phoning in. Appreciate your time. Craig Hallam of Wedbush, who's got a buy rating on shares of Tesla still, even though the company lost $4 billion in market cap over the past month. Gordon Johnson, in your view, where should be valued at right now?
I think Tesla's a $50 stock. Essentially, people are valuing this car, again, based on a...
Even though the company lost $4 billion in market cap over the past month.
It's good to see Melissa Lee back in the day, man. This guy, I remember him. His name was a... I think it was Pete Najarian or something like that. He was an options guy, man. And he was like, he was such a funny fella. He was like, oh, I didn't even know how to explain him. Like, he just looked always like he should be down at the beach in Florida or something like that.
And in your view, where should be valued at right now?
I think Tesla's a $50 stock. Essentially, people are valuing this car, again, based on a Gen 3 model for which there is no prototype. Tesla's cars cost about $80,000 to $90,000 right now. They're using essentially laptop batteries. They're packaging Panasonic laptop batteries into these car batteries, which are effectively the bulk of the cost. How are they, those batteries have been scaled up. How are they going to get more cost out of that? I don't know. I think the stock is grossly overvalued. I think the correction is not anywhere near done, and I'm selling the stock.
It's grossly overvalued. I'm selling the stock. It's off laptop batteries and all those sorts of things, right? And, you know, there's certain stocks you just get out of the way of. If you don't want to be long it, fine. You don't have to be long Tesla stock. It's not for everybody. But it's not one of those. A lot of people, for the past, ever since this company basically went public around, it was either 2010, 2011, Tesla went public, they've tried to bet against this company time and time again and, you know, short sell it, buy puts on it. This just isn't that type of stock, man. Just you either go long or you don't play with it at all. You can, especially knowing the runs that this stock goes on, and these short sellers, I mean, the amount of money they can lose. Because remember, when you short a stock, you have an unlimited loss ahead. Okay, unlimited. You buy Tesla stock, and Tesla stock goes bankrupt. Okay, which isn't going to happen. But let's say that happened, you lose 100% of your capital. If you're on the wrong side of a Tesla trade on a short side, you're going to lose hundreds of percent capital, or dare I say thousands of percent capital. You will lose your entire portfolio. Your entire account will end up being liquidated. Plus you're paying interest on all that as well, which is just a beautiful thing. And so at the end of the day, it's been like this for 10 plus years now at this point in time, folks. People love to hate on it. They love to short it. And at the end of the day, get out of the way. You either go long or you don't do anything with the stock. It's one of those sorts of companies. Next one.
14-day winning streak. Bryn, more than $200 billion in market cap added over that period of time. It's just astounding when you really put those numbers into context. 13 straight days, $200 billion in market cap. What do you do? By the way, target raised to 305 at RBC.
Is it really that crazy? Microsoft would only need to go up about 8%. 8%. I mean, that could happen after our earnings period, and it would have more market cap than that, or roughly the same market cap as that going up. So, you know, when these companies get bigger, it sounds like, wow, it's such a crazy number, but you got to understand the base it's coming off of.
Give us the thought process of an investor in this name watching that run happen and what you think.
And also, don't forget, Tesla lost about $700 billion of market cap in 2022 from where it entered the year versus where it exited the year. Also relevant to the conversation, should Tesla really have lost $700 billion market cap? I'm not so convinced of that.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's a volatile name. Obviously, Elon is everywhere, has his hands in so many different aspects. So I have half...
Elon is everywhere. You guys see him? He was with the main boss lady in Italy, I believe, recently. He was with the gentleman, Mr. LVMH. The guy he's usually battling out for richest man in the world. He was it Bernard Arnault or Nault or something like that? He's on a European tour right now. That's all I can say.
Position I just own outright. And the other half...
$800 billion market cap on Tesla roughly right now.
...calls against. And I keep getting those positions, which I'll sell like 15 to 20% out of the money calls, but the stock keeps moving higher, so that position will get taken away. So I have my core, and then with my other covered call, as the stock has moved higher, I am very comfortable selling calls against that, and if it gets called away, so be it. Because you have to understand, Tesla is probably the top option traded stock that has been all year, and so there's a ton of option premium. And so for me, when there's a ton of option premium, I'm happy to like make a 25% trade between the upside and selling calls. To me, that's the comfortable way to play it, because I do agree, like, their margins are going to come down. You can walk through, there's going to be more competition, but I just really believe that Elon is the Thomas Edison of our time. And not only is he a great inventor, he's a great producer, and he can mass manufacture. And just look what's happening with GM and Ford. Like, for them to go to Tesla just tells you how superior their technology is, even down to their superchargers. So I just think it's a long-term hold. I love what he's doing. I think that, you know, I own a Tesla, and just it's wonderful technology, and it's a fun car to drive.
Yeah, Robbie, how do you view this?
Well, listen, it's very hard to be invested in growth. If you're a manager that benchmarks yourself to the Russell 1000 growth index and you don't, this is the stat, you don't own Tesla.
Wait a minute. I got to be honest. I thought I've seen every single person that's ever gone on CNBC. I don't think I've seen this guy before. Rob Schickhan?
Amazon or Nvidia, which are up on average 114% this year. They've accounted for 8.5% of the return. So you just don't own those. You're under by 8.5. You got to be pretty darn good to make up that underperformance.
But that's been the nature of the market this year, given the
crazy
stocks that have run. When you look at, you know, discretionary as a sector, for a while was the second or third best sector. Why? Tesla,
yeah,
and Amazon,
yep,
and home builders, which had a great run too. But those two stocks alone carrying the weight of a whole sector, those group of stocks carrying the weight of, in some respects, the whole market.
And the question is, do you want to become a momentum investor or a fundamental-based investor? And in the question of NVIDIA...
That's a great question. How would you answer that?
And there's no such thing as a momentum-based investor. There's no such thing as that, okay? That's like, no, that doesn't even exist. There's momentum-based traders. There's momentum-based traders. There's fundamental investors. But there's no such thing as a momentum investor. That's a momentum trader. If you're looking at what are the hot stocks, and so these are stocks I got to pile into because these got the momentum right now. You're a trader. That's a trading activity. That's a gambling activity. That's not thinking about where this company's net incomes are going over the next several years, what they've proven in the past with their revenues and their profitability and their margins and their products versus their competitors and all that stuff. Like, that's a whole different game.
If there are a whole mass group of investors who are rethinking what they are and what they want to be, and in some cases what they have to be in this kind of market.
You know, if you have a strategy, it's ultimately going to work out if you hold true to your discipline, because momentum will break down and then you can get out of those names. Being fundamentally disciplined is incredibly tax efficient. It allows you to compound over time as long as the fundamentals stay healthy. So I think in the short run, you know, momentum's had its day. It's likely to continue to have its day. Okay? In the intermediate run, I think you want to be mindful of fundamentals, which is exactly why we trimmed our Microsoft position a little bit, right? So we've done that throughout the year, where we've owned these big positions in our growth portfolio. The momentum has gotten tremendous, but then at some point, valuation becomes a ceiling.
Something tells me you're not backing up the tractor anytime soon for Tesla.
Well, I think you know what's on my mind, right? Why do I not own Tesla, but why do I own GM? And Rob just said something pretty smart here. You know, if you've got a strategy, you got to stick to it, all right? You got to stick to your knitting. It's actually something my father said to me a long time ago and drove it home, okay? Now, look, if I buy Tesla at any price, I can't tell you why that...
Hold your horses for just a flip and flapjacking moment. What are we talking about here, okay? Don't hold true to your strategy if your strategy's bad, okay? If you got a bad strategy, you need to update your strategy, okay? If you're having trouble beating the market, you need to update your strategy, okay? Especially if it's happening over a 3, 5, 7 year time horizon, you don't just stick with it to stick with it, okay? That usually ends up bad, okay? And so at the end of the day, you've got to have a concrete strategy. You've got to understand financials of companies. You've got to understand valuations. You've got to understand competitive threats. You've got to do SWOT analysis on companies. And you've got to be able to see around the corner a little bit and look at things in different ways than an average Wall Streeter looks at them. If you're looking at it all the same way they look at it, you have no advantage. You have no advantage in this market. Millions of people know how to read an income statement. Millions of people know how to read a balance sheet. I could go to any business college and they could read me an income statement and say, oh, this line item. At the end of the day, that's just part of this game. You've got to be able to look at businesses differently, see around the corner, understand, like I did with Tesla, where I said, you know what, I think this is where this industry's going. I think this is the next wave. And I was right about that, right? Obviously, Elf Cosmetics was one I was right about. The vegan industry, I was wrong about. So sometimes you're going to make those mistakes. But the big thing is, as long as you're right a lot more than you're wrong, The money pours in, folks. The money pours in, and the gains are ridiculous. And that's how you get those 10x stocks, 20x stocks, 50x stocks, 100x stocks. If you saw the energy drink industry in the early 2000s, and you saw Hansen's Natural Beverage, which had the product called Monster, and you're like, I think this is going to be big. I think these products are addictive. I think a lot of people are going to be buying these over the next few years, and it's going to grow into a big industry. You made 100,000 plus percent on that stock. 100,000 plus percent. $1 equals 100,000 plus dollars. $10 equals a million. $100 equals 10 million? You gotta be flipping my flapjacks, man.
It's the right price to buy it at. And I have to answer to clients when they say, look, it was 200, it went to 100. Why did you buy it at 200? If I can't justify that, I won't do it. Now in GM, I can justify it, and here's why. Besides the fact that the multiples are too low, besides the fact that the estimates are going up, here's the most important thing. They're buying back shares. This is where valuation matters to a guy like me, okay? They have the cash flow at this price to buy back shares, shrinking their share count 5% year over year at the last quarter, and they're doing it at 70% of book value. Now, I can go on and on about the autonomous vehicle, the cruise business, the electric vehicle business. I did get a Lyric. It's a pretty sexy car. I mean, I really kind of like it. I do think their strategy is good, but at the end of the day, Scott, this is why valuation matters.
Hey, his strategy is going to work. Remember the late 90s. Momentum carried the day for a very long time, and then we entered the early part of the 2000s, and hedge funds became stars. Why? Because they're fundamentalists, and they were looking at all those stocks and identified all those stocks
hedge funds are fundamentalists?
Were relatively inexpensive and began to explode.
I'm so disgusted. I'm so disgusted by everything I just heard in that last minute of that video. What is going on here? What are we doing? What are we doing? GM, okay, first off, let me just attack that point. I can't even deal with the rest of that. GM spending all this money on share buybacks, and this guy's applauding that. Their whole industry's changing, and you think it's brilliant that they're going to spend all their money on share buybacks? When we got a fundamental shift of two massive things in an industry at the same time, which is going over to EVs, going from internal combustion engines to EVs, and the second part is going from we drive the cars around to the cars are going to drive us around. We're going through these two massive technological shifts, and you're happy they're spending over there? Oh, come on, man. GM needs to be saving every penny they got right now. They shouldn't be paying a dividend right now. They shouldn't be doing share buybacks right now. None of that. They need to be worried about making sure they're around 10 years from now. Okay? It shows how behind they are, knowing that they have to partner with Tesla to use Tesla Supercharger Network. That just shows that their priorities aren't in the right place, man. Come on. Get it together. Get it together. Thank you very much, folks, for joining me as always. 29,000 plus subscribers now on the channel. If you enjoy my content, you want to support my content, do so on Patreon. That's linked in the description area down there. I also have that as a pinned comment. I just bought stocks yesterday in there. You get to see the stocks I'm buying and selling in there each week in that Patreon portfolio through Fidelity Investments. I appreciate y'all. Much love, and have a great day.